too.
Good, okay. Case, for Bill's parents.
We love you guys.
Thank you for doing that.
Thank you. Thank you. Good afternoon. My name is Grant Call. I am the senior pastor at Fellowship Bible Church. I want you to know on behalf of the family, it is a privilege to have you here. Thank you for being with us and for all the many people who are joining us online. We want to thank you for being a part of this very special service that we have planned. I want to tell you the reasons why we have gathered. First of all, we're here to honor Bill's memory. Second, we are also here to draw comfort from the God of all comfort. And as Bill would want it, we're here to glorify God. So let's begin our service with a time of prayer. Lord, we want to thank you for this opportunity to come into your presence. And Lord, we take great comfort knowing that you know our deepest needs and you care for us. And when we turn to you, we can find strength. And Lord, we're asking now that you would work in each one of our hearts. Would you meet our greatest need? Would you bring the comfort that only you can bring? Help us to honor the memory and the legacy of Bill Worthington. And would you glorify yourself? We ask this as we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, this afternoon I'd like to read a passage that is extremely meaningful to Bill. It's found in the Gospel of Matthew, beginning in verse 22. I'm sure you're familiar with this scene, but I would like for you to listen to it as if hearing it for the very first time. Immediately, Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go ahead of him to the other side, while he sent the crowds away. And after he had sent the crowds away, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. And when it was evening, he was there alone. But the boat was already a long distance from the land, battered by the waves, for the wind was contrary. And in the fourth watch of the night, he came to them, walking on the sea. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified and said, "It is a ghost." And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, "Take courage, it is I. Do not be afraid." And Peter said to him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." And he said, "Come." And Peter got out of the boat and walked on the water and came toward Jesus. But seeing the wind, he became frightened, and beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." And immediately Jesus stretched out his hand and took hold of him and said to him, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" When they got into the boat, the wind stopped, and those who were in the boat worshipped him, saying, "You certainly are God's son." I would like you to take some time to reflect on this passage and on Bill's life as we listen to one of the hymns that was so especially meaningful to Bill, "It Is Well." Song that has really ministered to the saints great encouragement, especially in times of significant trial, that when our faith is truly in Jesus, even in the great storms, it can be well with our soul because our faith is in Him. William Worthington was born to Dolores Dericole and William Worthington III in Upper Darby, Pennsylvania, August 1st, 1966. He spent all of his growing up years, the first 18 years of his life, in Downington, Pennsylvania. He is the oldest child, and talk about a natural-born leader. He was also always seeking new adventures and endeavors, growing up with his sister Bonnie and his younger brother Andrew. Now, this family has a lot of stories of growing up with Bill. One, Andrew recalls when he was about 5 or 6, they'd come home from school, and as would be the case for many kids, what do? You lock on to Scooby-Doo, right? You watch the little TV show, and so they would be doing that, and it was right after Halloween, and apparently Andrew had a big stash of candy. He said, hey, let's celebrate. And so he brings out his bag of candy, and he gives Bill some, which is great. Well, the next day, came home from school, and it's a repeat of the celebration. And all of a sudden, Andrew's offering Bill some of his candy, and Bill said, hey, wait, you don't have to keep sharing your candy with me. It's yours. And that left such an impression because, you know, what kid would voluntarily reject candy? But what it sent a message and communicated very early on that Bill would always watch out for his siblings. He always had their best interest in mind. He was a great big brother. Now, there are many memories that the family could share. Memories of Bill helping them out in tough situations, protecting them, looking out for them at times, like even eating their favorite leftover balsamic chicken, or helping them in some great difficulty that they found themselves. As we know, Bill always had a smile on his face. That got started apparently very early on. And there are some legendary lore that the family could tell you about the growing up days of Bill Worthington. One story they particularly loved to tell, this must have been quite a moment, apparently the parents always had a traditional date night, and guess who was in charge? Bill, of the kids. Now, the typical meal that they would have would be Chef Boyardee pizza in a box. You remember that? You kind of even sprinkle on the little seasonings there, and Bill would make that for the kids. And everything was fine until Bill apparently was noticing some sort of sound, or perhaps someone was outside. And so he runs up to the window, and sure enough, he looks, and he sees someone. All of a sudden, that protective leader kicked into high gear, and he gathered the kids together, put them together, and he did what any responsible kid would do. He called the police. Well, the police showed up, and Bill walked him through the situation, explained to him. They said, well, can you show us exactly what happened? Where did you see this individual? And so they went up to the window, and Bill turned on his flashlight before, and lo and behold, the police officers had it all figured out. They knew exactly who was that individual that seemed to be spying on them. It was Bill's reflection. And I want you to know that Bill has never lived that down. It seems like this story just keeps surfacing over and over. They just couldn't let that one slide. Bill was such a young man of adventure, of protection. He was very involved in the Civil Air Patrol. He worked as a paperboy. He also earned his Eagle Scout. In fact, you can see that in the back when you walk in. He was always looking to better himself and to improve his community. And he graduated from Downington High School in 1984. After high school, Bill packed up his big black trunk and hopped on a plane, where he became a proud member of the Corps of Cadets at Texas A&M University in College Station, Texas. He bled maroon and white, and he had many stories, as do all of the guys from the Corps, of what they did to each other and the adventures that they shared, all part of A&M lore, and he proudly wore that Aggie ring. He earned a Bachelor of Science in Engineering, and he went on to be an engineering project manager at Brown & Root and Halliburton Oil in Houston, Texas. It was during this time that he also served in the United States Air Force Reserves. Now, for all of us who know Bill, we know that he was just a highly intelligent, brilliant man. Not all of you know this, but he was a member of Mensa, and he scored a near perfect score on his GMAT. He later went on to earn an MBA from Penn State University, and at the same time, Wyatt launched a business to serve the development and sales needs of family-owned businesses in the Philadelphia area. He was always learning, and he really was intrigued about the complexities of organizational governance. William pursued advanced studies and attained a PhD from Texas A&M University and a minor in international security from the George Bush School of Government and Public Service. His research and publications had a lot of focus on operational resilience and sculpted from the values embedded within the companies and the firms. Bill is widely published both in academic and in practical journals. And in 2007, Bill joined the Baylor University family. It was a great fit for Bill, who not only had a strong love for the Lord, but also pursued an excellence in academics, where he became then a professor of strategy and family business at the Hankamer School of Business, as well as the director of the Institute for the Family Business at Baylor University. Bill was a mentor and a teacher at heart. He loved to invest in his students. Why? He took this to a whole new level when he became part of the Baylor business in Europe, where he would take students to Europe. And not only would these be great times of teaching, but these would also be significant times of investment in the lives of these students. One of the things that Bill is known for as a professor is his ability to weave in the truths of Scripture with the concepts that he was presenting to his students. He was known for academic excellence and a love for the Lord. What a great combination. Dr. Worthington also founded the King's Council, and that served as a confidential external advisory that aligns organizations with their values and really helps to illuminate how one can live out their Christian faith in the context of vocation. Bill was an active member of multiple organizations like the Greater Waco Chamber of Commerce, Thousand Friends of Waco, Rotary International, the World Affairs Council of Dallas and Fort Worth. He was, of course, a part of the American Mensa, an Eagle Scout, and an Assistant Scout Master. But at the heart of great love for Bill was his family. Bill loved his family in tremendous ways. He loved being a husband and a father. As I mentioned, Bill just always seemed to have a smile. And I've known Bill since 2007 when we became friends and he became a member of Fellowship Bible Church. But Bill's smile got about 10 times bigger when he met Sarah and her three boys. It was just like it fit. And I had lunches and stuff with Bill and we'd had different conversations. But when Sarah came on the scene, all of a sudden there was a whole new level of joy and a big bounce in Bill's step. And I actually had a front row seat to watch all this because I had the privilege of doing their premarital counseling. And so every Wednesday night they'd be in my office and we'd be going through it. And they were just so in love with each other. I'm not sure if what I was saying made any sense or anything, but you could tell this was a couple that God was putting together, and it was a joy to be a part of not only their counseling, getting ready for marriage, but to share in their ceremony. And the kids, this family, known as Team W, Benjamin, Oliver, Elliot, Emerson, and William Worthington V, known as Team W, this is a team that loved together, lived together. And they shared so many experiences. And I want you to know that your dad loved all of them. Whether it be the little leagues or the daddy-daughter dances or the tea parties or the chess matches, all of the camping trips, the dad and son's dates going out to John Lilly's. He was an avid supporter of the China Spring Cougar Marching Band and also a part of the China Spring Boy Scout Troop 444. I want you to know that all of these memories and the times being able to spend and invest with you kids as a family, this meant everything to him. Now, Bill also had a really good sense of humor. And you can just ask the kids and they'll be able to tell you some of his cheesy jokes, you know? Like, one of the cheesy jokes that he's really famous for is that he would ask them this: what do you call a poem that doesn't rhyme? And the answer, a draft. And then he'd start laughing, you know, and even though the kids had heard this before, he had these cheesy jokes, but he found them very funny, and the fact that he found them funny helped everybody else to find them funny. And, you know, Bill was a brilliant man, but despite being just, you know, intellectually at this super high level, he had trouble remembering the correct names for things. And he'd oftentimes kind of get them mixed up. That would even happen even with the doctors and nurses. He would have medicine, but he'd get the names mixed up, and he'd have it all confused. But he'd have the nurses and even the doctors in stitches, and they're trying to keep a straight face. It was all part of life and fun with Bill. But he loved his family deeply. In fact, his greatest achievement, he would say, was his children and the investments that he was able to make in each of you and all of you. He is proud of every one of you, and he wants the lessons and the investments that he has made to be your legacy that you will carry on. Bill loves Sarah with, I would say, an uncommon commitment. One that I would find as a pastor that would be admirable and rare. You probably don't know this, but every day from the day of their marriage until December 23rd, while in the ICU, Bill would ask Sarah to marry him. They shared a date night every Thursday. Oftentimes, of late, that would be in hospital beds or waiting rooms, in infusion chairs. But he was a most thoughtful and protective husband. And it was said, and he would say, it was his greatest privilege to get to love Sarah. If ever a couple had a deep-seated admiration and appreciation for one another, it would be Bill and Sarah. And when you look at the composite of a man's life like Bill, you have to ask the question, how does this happen? It doesn't happen by chance. It certainly wasn't random. The bedrock and the heart of Bill's life is his faith in Christ. This gets started very early on. At the age of 8, coming home from Sunday school one day, he announces to his parents with a big smile on his face that he had placed his faith in Jesus as his Savior. And so from an early age, God had started this relationship with Bill that only grew over the years. His mother, Dolores, had a very strong influence in his developmental years and him growing in his faith initially. There is a man that I heard about that when Bill went away for military training, he roomed with a guy who is absolutely sold out for Jesus, a completely Christ-centered man, and this left a very strong impression on Bill's life. In fact, it was life-changing to encounter a man who was just authentically living his life for Christ. This shows us again the power of influence, and had a tremendous influence on Bill's life, to pattern his life to also be a completely, thoroughly Christ-centered man. As I said, Bill loved the classic hymns. He supported many missionaries quietly, and he also had a compassion child. All of this stems from a heart that loves Jesus, knows forgiveness of sin, knows relationship with God, and cares enough about people, as God does, to invest in them. Being Christ-centered and never taking that for granted was extremely important to Bill. He was a vital member of Fellowship Bible Church, and I would just have to say, Bill Worthington was a privilege to have in our church. It was a joy for me to be his pastor and his friend. His faith led him to make disciples. He valued mentoring. Just like Jesus had commissioned all of those who truly know him and follow him, you were to make disciples. For instance, I'd like to share just an excerpt from a friend of his by the name of Rob Holman. This was passed on to me, but I think you will get a little bit of his heart for mentoring from this quote. Bill's indescribable kindness helped me change from my way of thinking into God's way of thinking. His generosity, thoughtfulness, and service touched my life in extraordinary ways that affected my family and business relationships. I'll never forget Bill encouraging me to pursue asking Karen, who is now my wife of 16 years, out for the first time and helping mentor me in business early in my professional career. These two things have proven to be foundational into who I am and what I do. He faithfully followed Jesus and modeled a way of life that was anchored in humility, hospitality, and love. And so when we look at Bill's life and his legacy, we see his character fully on display. If there was ever a man who was truly kind and good, That would be Bill. He was determined. You know, he pursued his PhD when he was in his 30s. He was a type A guy, and I can relate to that. But he was God's man and under God's control. He was brilliant. He was very intelligent. But he was also very humble. And he used his expertise, his training, and his opportunities to better others. He was a really interesting guy. He was what we would call a growth mindset, continuous improvement individual. He was always reading books, especially motivational books. He had a wide spectrum of interest. He was an avid reader. When asked, hey, don't you think you have too many books? He would say, no, we'll just keep building more bookcases. He had lots of magazine subscriptions. He always wanted to be a pilot, but due to his eyesight, that basically held him back from pursuing that. He was motivating. Just being around him and listening to him, he always was like putting things up on his wall that would motivate him to dream bigger, to take the next step. He had idea boards and maps and newspaper articles, and he was always looking for what is the next step. And one of the things that motivated him was his kids' artwork, which he actually proudly displayed in his home. Bill was brave, courageous. He battled disease for the last 5 years. I have never known anyone who had so many health challenges for so long and to face them with such courage, faith, and joy. I mean, Bill had over 130 chemo cycles. He had hundreds of transfusions. He had a bone marrow transplant that required 42 days in the hospital. He had multiple surgeries. And one other characteristic I would bring to your mind is that Bill was protective. In fact, that's what his name means, protector. And he did that at every level possible. He was looking to protect Sarah and the kids' hearts. And he always watched out, and for anyone, would watch out for their safety. And in my friendship with Bill, I saw a man for a passion for truth, for God, and for Christ and his kingdom. Bill, in my estimation, is a truly successful man, not just for his accomplishments, and that's what the world looks like. What sort of accomplishments do you have? What's on your resume? What makes Bill a truly great man is not just what he did. It's who he was, who he became, a man so thoroughly like Jesus. I asked if I could name one value that Bill would want to pass on to the next generation. This is how Sarah responded. That you would live out your values. And these are his values in the order in which he pursued them. To love God, to love your spouse, and then to love your children. As he would remind us so frequently, a cord of three strings is not easily broken. That's why he made such an emphasis that each of us would be thoroughly Christ-centered. I asked if I could say just one thing. What do you think Bill would want me to say at his memorial service? And this is what Sarah replied. He'd tell others to run this race well, not to look back with regrets, but to keep taking steps each day and to embrace and soak in each and every moment while keeping your eyes on Christ. And that is what Bill did. He gave us a legacy of life in Christ and how to love people well. And on Thursday, December 24th, having run the race of his life, Bill entered into the presence of his God and Savior, whom he served so very well. And I can't help but to just keep thinking of what this is like for Bill, to be in the presence of Jesus and to hear him say, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." You know, all of us gathered here in person, and all of us that are gathered online, we all have stories that we could share. And so we're going to listen to a song that Bill heard on the very day that he had heard from his doctor that you've got cancer, 5 years ago. It's a song by Shane and Shane. It was passed on to him. It's called "Sovereign Over Us." And so as we listen to this song, let us also reflect on the lessons and the legacy of Bill Worthington in our lives. Let us ask of God how we can grow and mature in God's grace. And let us use this as a time to reflect on this fine man.
Working for our good, for your glory.
What a powerful song. That God is faithful forever. And that he is sovereign over us. And certainly if there was a man who knew and lived that truth, it would be the man that we've gathered today to honor. As I said at the beginning of our service, this scene in Matthew where Jesus actually walks on water was a passage that was very significant in Bill's life. And that's because every single person walks through storms. That's true of me. It's true of you. We've all been living through a pandemic. We have watched our society unravel. We have faced all sorts of challenges economically and as a society. And even personally, many of us have gone through great challenges and health issues. How do we go through storms like this? You know, you gotta come to a place where you ask, why? Why are we going through these challenges? How are we going to make it? What is God trying to teach us through the storms that we are going through? How do we make sense of the storm? That's what Matthew 14, beginning in verse 22, that's why this passage is so important and was so important to Bill. And Sarah asked if I would just take a few minutes to share why this is such a significant passage to Bill and really to all of us. You know, if you do not learn the lessons that Jesus is teaching his disciples, and this was a significant event in the training of the 12, then when you face your challenges and difficulties, it's not going to make a lot of sense, and it's probably going to send you into a downward spiral because you're missing pieces of understanding. And so let's take a look at it. Matthew 14, beginning in verse 22. Immediately, Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go ahead of them to the other side while he sent the crowds away. Jesus actually compelled his disciples. They actually wanted to stay with him, but he was sending them from Bethsaida to the west side of the Sea of Galilee. This was all Jesus doing. They frankly would have preferred to stay with him, and they really wanted Jesus to be with him, but no. This time, he was sending them on the lake, and he was not going to be with them. And it says that Jesus sent the crowds away, and then in verse 23, after he had sent the crowds away, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. And when it was evening, he was there alone. And here we see Jesus in the midst of an activity that was extremely important to him in his earthly ministry. And that was prayer, conversing with his Father. And Jesus would be praying about and asking for strength for what lies ahead. Praying and asking God to prepare him for the days and the challenges and the lessons that he would teach. But he was also praying for the development of his disciples. You see, the reason that Jesus sent his men away on the boat onto the lake is he is planning to teach them and to develop their faith. Now, at least four of the disciples, Peter, James, John, and Andrew, what were they? What was their occupation? They were fishermen. They had spent a lifetime on the lake. And what Jesus was about to do is he was going to break them in their strength. You see, if you're a gifted individual, the problem is that you will trust in the gift and not your God. And so Jesus had to use the very thing they thought they were very best at, operating a boat on a lake, to bring them to a place of complete dependence upon him. And so Jesus sends them out. He's praying, and he is alone. But it says then in verse 24, but the boat was already a long distance from land, battered by the waves, for the wind was contrary. So Jesus sends them out onto a lake, and he sends them into a storm. The storm didn't catch Jesus by surprise. In fact, he knew the storm was going to occur. And storms on the Sea of Galilee can occur at a pretty rapid pace. I mean, all of a sudden it can be a pretty decent day like it was this morning. And all of a sudden the storm moves in and you got rain and you got waves. And in this case, they were being battered. The wind was contrary and they were literally being beat up by the waves that they were facing. And so you have to ask, like, why the storms? What would be the purpose of such a storm? Well, as you read the Bible, there are three reasons why God brings storms or allows for them. Some are storms of correction. You see this in the nation of Israel, guys like Jonah. You know, if you're on a path of disobeying and disregarding God, and you think you're smarter than him and you're going to do it your way, I want you to know, that's the hard way of going through life. God has a way of getting your attention. He can bring storms. He can completely change your orientation. Some of the storms are storms of development to bring you to greater depths of understanding, greater depths of faith. And some storms are storms that come as the result of a fall, like a hurricane, or like COVID-19, or cancer. There is natural evil, and there's even moral evil, all as a result of the fall that exists in our world. And they bring about storms. But in this case, Jesus sends them into a storm for developmental reasons. This verse, when we read this passage, you know what it tells us? You can be perfectly in the center of God's will. You can be doing exactly good what God wants you to do. And you can still be in a storm. Sometimes when we're in storms, we're like, ah, why is this happening to me? What's wrong? What have I done? You know, and you're trying to figure this out. I want you to know, you can be at the center of God's will and be in a storm. That's where these men are. You see, Jesus is training them. He's developing them. And storms can hit unexpectedly. And that's what happened here. And so verse 24, but the boat was already a long distance from land, battered by the waves, for the wind was contrary. And in the fourth watch, so that would be between 3 and 6 a.m. So these boys have been at it for about 9 hours, fighting the storm, paddling and rowing for their life. They are completely exhausted. Sometime between 3 and 6 a.m., it says this, in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus came to them walking on the sea. This is profound. Only God controls creation. Jesus walking on a stormy sea is exemplifying his deity, that indeed he's God. And he's approaching them on this as they're battling it out on the sea. He's walking on it. Verse 26, when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified and said, "It is a ghost." And they cried out in fear. They thought they were seeing some sort of, in Greek, phantasma, some sort of apparition. They just had no idea. They were absolutely terrified. And then Jesus speaks these words to them. Verse 27. But immediately, Jesus spoke to them, saying, "Take courage. Be brave," literally. "It is I. Do not be afraid." He literally says, "It is I. I am." Referencing when God revealed his personal name at the burning bush. Remember that in Exodus chapter 3, verse 14? "Who is it that's sending me?" You tell him, "I am." God's personal name. And Jesus says, "Do not be afraid. I am. It is I. Take courage." So why did Jesus walk on the water? Jesus walked on the water to show them that the very thing they feared, the storm, was really a staircase for them to come to know him deeply. That's so very important when we're in our storms. These aren't random. God is using them intentionally to bring about a depth of relationship with himself. Well, then, why did they not recognize Jesus? I mean, they've been traveling with him. Why did they not recognize Jesus walking on the water. And that's because they weren't looking for him. You see, fear and faith cannot reside at the same time in a human heart. And so he comes to them, he says, "Do not be afraid, it is I." And then this most remarkable event, Peter said to him, "Lord, if it is you," it could be translated, "since it is you, command me to come to you on the water." He uses a term that he would, like a king, would command. Direct me, command me, you command me to walk on the water to you. And so, verse 29, Jesus said, "Come." And here is some event that I'm sure that everyone in the boat, and especially Peter, would never forget. And Peter got out of the boat and walked on the water and came toward Jesus. There has never been a human that has ever walked on water except Peter. And Peter is walking on the water, coming toward Jesus. I mean, can't you see it? He's just like, I'm not sinking. He's looking at Jesus. He's taking these steps. All the guys in the boat, they're just totally locked on, like, whoa, what is happening? And then, all of a sudden, though, verse 30, but seeing the wind, he became frightened and began to sink, and he cried out, "Lord, save me." Now, I want you to know that Peter takes a lot of flack. You know, Peter just didn't have enough faith. You know, it's one thing to be an armchair quarterback and just to kind of sit there and like, yeah, that guy, you know, Peter, what a loser. But Peter got out of the boat. And there's some things that Peter learned about Jesus that were so very important. That Jesus had the ability for him to do what Peter would think would be impossible. And another thing that Peter learned about Jesus is that no matter what or how deep he thought he might be sinking, Jesus could save him. You know, what happened is Peter got focused back onto the storm. And when he did, he took his eyes off Jesus and he started sinking. You know, that's true for us. When we start really looking closely at our storms, and I've got some storms in my life, when I start fixating on them, what happens? I start sinking, right? What do you do when you're sinking? One of the great prayers of the Bible was given to us by Peter. In fact, I encourage you to memorize it. It's literally this: "Lord, save me." You can't get better theology, and you can't find a better prayer. Lord, save me. You know, every time God hears that, it's music to his ears. You know, all of us need to make this our prayer as well. I mean, we've all missed the mark. We're all self-centered. We put God on a shelf. We've lived and tried to do life on our own program. We are sinners by nature, and we sin, and we hurt people and hurt ourselves, and we offend God. That's why Jesus came. He came, born as a baby, lived a perfect life, died as a perfect sacrifice on a cross to pay the penalty of sin. The wages of sin is death. And he rose again so that every one of us who believes, we can have forgiveness of sin, life eternal with God. We can know with certainty that our home is heaven if we're trusting in Jesus. But you know how that can be your certainty? If this prayer is yours, "Lord, save me." And when we're in trouble and facing difficulty, and you don't even know what to pray, just pray this: "Lord, save me." And immediately, Jesus stretched out his hand, took hold of him, and said to him, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" And when they got into the boat, the wind stopped, and those who were in the boat worshipped him, saying, "You are certainly God's son." I want you to know that our trial will end the moment God chooses to end it. You see, there's something profound that takes place when Jesus, Peter, gets back in the boat with all the rest of the guys. They worship him. Prior to this, They served him. They were learning a lot about Jesus. They knew about Jesus. They were serving Jesus. But here we see they are worshiping him. Friends, this is the ultimate priority. This is the purpose that you and I are designed for. That we come to a place where we are worshiping Jesus. And you're asking, well then, how do we make sense of the storm? We do so by coming to a place to knowing that Jesus is right here with us. And when we worship him, even in the midst of our difficulties, we're fulfilling the purpose for which we are designed, and we're bringing God great glory. When we're praying, when we're really, truly, sincerely talking with God, when we're singing, when we're serving, when we're giving, when we are meditating on Scripture, when we are thinking deeply about its truth, and when we are loving God and people well, when we are worshiping, friends, we're accomplishing the purpose God designed for the storm. But that doesn't make life easy. And even a day like this can be filled with some significant challenges. How do we move forward each day? Several years ago, I was part of a panel at Dallas Theological Seminary. There was another professor. We were doing Q&A with our students. Robert Jeffress was sitting by my side. One of the students asked a very similar question about how do you make it through the storms and the difficulties of life? I mean, we all know them, right? And he told this story, and I've never forgot it. He said that he and Amy were driving in West Texas and on one of those small, windy, little narrow roads, and then the storm just hit. I mean, you know how they have these torrential downpours here in Texas? It was a deluge. And Robert said, I could hardly see. I mean, I could barely see. We were just barely moving along the road. And I was like, doing everything I could. And then he couldn't believe it, but there was a truck that came and just passed him by, going quite a bit faster than Robert. And I'm like, Robert turned to Amy and said, you know what? That truck is going to the same town we are. I'm going to follow the lights on that truck, because there's only one place that this road goes to. And so he did. And so he got right up behind that truck, and he followed that truck all the way into the town in which they were going. And friends, if today is a day where it seems like it's raining so hard, and the storm is so great, and you can barely see in front of you, follow the lights. Remember that God is sovereign. Follow the lights, that God is good, that God is a savior. And when we say, Lord, save me from the heart, we can know this: God will bring us safely home. And friends, these are the truths that Bill has so fully lived and now fully realizes. Let's close in prayer. Lord, I want to thank you for the opportunity just to open up your word on this day that we celebrate the life legacy of Bill Worthington. Would you, God, bring comfort? Would you reinforce your truth in our hearts? And if there is someone that is here today or watching online that has never truly trusted in your son Jesus as their savior and the Lord of their life, like Bill has, would they just pray with me now and say, God, I turn from myself and my sin, and on this very significant day, I put my trust, my faith in your son Christ. Lord, help us all to walk in your ways, to know your goodness, to trust you, to follow the lights, even in the midst of the storm. For your glory, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, at this time, we're going to have a time of remembrance and tribute. Two songs have been selected by Sarah and the family, You Are My Hero by Dennis Jernigan, and then this song, Well Done. So let's reflect on the life of Bill Worthington, a life well lived, as we watch the slideshow.
Thank you.
Well done. Well done. Paul wrote in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, "For we do not want you to be uninformed, brethren, about those who are asleep, so that you will not grieve as do the rest who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep in Jesus." You know, everything that Bill took by faith, right now, it is sight. On behalf of the family, thank you so much for being with us in person and for all of you who have joined us online for the remembrance and the celebration of a life well lived, the life of Bill Worthington. Thank you.
This will conclude the chapel portion of today's celebration. I'd like to ask that if you are going to go to Chatham Springs Cemetery, it will just be a brief moment before we load up and proceed in that direction. We ask that you use this opportunity to go ahead and use the bathroom or what have you. Please proceed to your vehicles and turn on your headlights and flashes for safety. We'd also like to say thank you to those who will not be following us to the cemetery. Thank you so much for your attendance and your presence today. It is greatly appreciated, and it's truly been an honor to have you here today. At this time, the chapel services are concluded. We ask that you please proceed to the back exit. Unless you're going to the cemetery, we ask that you remain in line. When we are ready to depart, police escort will organize us and we will safely depart. Thank you.
Paul Bearer,
Chris, if you and Jim would just give us just a little bit, we're going to get everything packed up, and then you'll help us to the coach. Thank you so much. Let's go down the hallway with you. We'll go ahead and get this all good with us. Yeah, we'll go this way and put it in.